Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Obituary by Ron Franscell, narrated by Joe Barrett. You never know, as you move through these labyrinths, whether you are pursuing a goal or running from yourself, whether you are the hunter or his prey. Joseph Brodsky, Watermark. Night Pirates. Tuesday, June 3rd, 2003. Pearly Benson could have used a little more time. With a few more seconds, he might have been able to call for help on his cell phone. With a few more minutes, he might have prayed or pleaded for a few more minutes. With another hour, he might have made himself ready to die. But it all happened too quickly. While the Burlington, Iowa truck driver, a single father of four, slept in an empty interstate rest area just outside Spearfish, South Dakota, three men crept into his Peterbilt sleeper cab a little after 3 a.m. One of them, wielding a small sledgehammer, patted a sharpened railroad spike through Pearly's eye socket into his dreaming brain. He didn't even have time to hurt. But pain was inefficient, and these pirates were nothing if not cold-bloodedly efficient. They drove Pearly's truck west into Wyoming. Beneath a highway overpass at a dark little border town called Beulah, they dumped Pearly's still warm body in the bed of a waiting pickup, which transported him to a secluded, lonely hole already custom dug for him in the Wyoming prairie. Pearly would spend eternity in shallow, foreign earth, far from his home and children, never found. 1 hour later, right on schedule, they were met at a truck stop, where three more men in rubber gloves swept the trailer for tracking devices. They found four, which were disarmed and dismantled on the spot, long before the truck or Pearly were ever missed. They also hacked into the Qualcomm satellite system from a laptop in their black van and removed the tracking dish from the top of the rig. For anyone who cared, including the feds, Pearly's stolen truck was rendered invisible from the protective satellites overhead. And Pearly's load, a wide array of pharmaceuticals, due to be dropped at a Walmart warehouse in Minneapolis, Minnesota, was already sold. Broken up in the foreign and domestic black market, it would net more than $3 million. The hijackers would eventually barter Pearly's repainted Peterbilt for a stolen rail shipment of military weapons and explosives in Mobile, Alabama. The brown stain in the sleeper was said to be spilled battery acid, but even the truth wouldn't have mattered much. In their world, battery acid was spilled everywhere. And Pearly's four fatherless kids, their mother long dead, would be scattered by Iowa's overworked social services department to four different foster families, where they inevitably would come to hate the government for what it took from them. All in all, it was a good night for the fourth sign. Chapter 1. Jefferson Morgan inhaled, wondering if particles of death floated on cemetery air. After a night of rain, the graveyard smells like sweet resurrection. The morning sun draws out the damp, the dark, and the ferment, and they mingle as they rise on the warming air. The long dead floated in the June morning, cleansed by both clay and concealment in Wyoming's ancient soil. He knew well that death in its various other forms was not so fragrant. He'd smelled most of them. Morgan was sure even the stink of Laddie Granbouche had mellowed. Laddie's tomb, a modest above-ground chamber built of red sandstone from the fabled hole-in-the-wall country, was disintegrating. Vandals, rigorous winters, and riding lawnmowers had taken their toll. Cracks spidered across the base, some wide enough for a man's fingers, and the mortar seal around the vault had dissolved. It was also sinking into the overwatered cemetery topsoil. Ever the newspaper man, Morgan kneeled close for a photo. Only Laddie's epitaph remained intriguingly proud. Laddie Granbouche, 1876 to 1969. Yesterday is history, tomorrow is mystery. So before the tomb collapsed entirely, spilling what might be left of Laddie after 30 dead years, the Perry County Commissioners decided to rebuild it in a new section of Winchester's Pine Lawn Cemetery. Besides, it didn't take much to qualify as a tourist attraction in any small town, and Laddie was the closest thing to a celebrity in Winchester, Wyoming. It was a Saturday morning at the end of a long week. Morgan snapped a few pictures of her next-to-final resting place for next week's bullet before the cemetery caretaker started dismantling it. This was big news in a small town where no news was nothing new, and the editor always worked harder on slow news weeks, which was most. And although it was unlikely Laddie's bone dust would tell any new tales, a small cadre of curious forensic anthropologists under the renowned Dr. Sean Cowper of the University of South Florida hovered around Laddie's grave that morning to take measure of the old gal. A surgical mask hung around each of their necks as they prepared for the exhumation of Laddie's husk. Morgan zoomed in on a pretty grad student, one of Cowper's helpers. She seemed too young and full of life for the work of death. Under her polar tech pullover, earmuffs, and two pairs of rubber gloves, she resented the chill of Wyoming morning, even in June. Poor little Florida girl, Morgan thought. Her perky nose ran in the chilly morning, and she nibbled a glazed donut with the same ambivalent zeal the Donner Party approached lunch. Maybe it was her first exhumation, or maybe just her first Wyoming morning. Laddie died in her sleep on a hot summer night in 1969, a natural and unremarkable end for a living mystery. She'd lived alone as long as anyone could remember, holed up in her Riverstone mansion at La Plata Ranch beneath the sheltering bud-red rimrock in the Badlands north of Winchester. She wasn't a recluse, but she loved being alone. And if the myth she cultivated in the last half of her long life were authentic, and many people believed it was, she might have preferred the sanctuary of open spaces. At any rate, she lay in her four-poster bed for 2 days before the county agent found her. If the truth be known, he never actually saw Laddie's putrefying remains. He merely smelled them from the front porch and radioed the sheriff from his truck. Laddie was 93 years old, and her body just gave out. She had lived passionately and loved passionately, if the stories were true. She was one of the West's most legendary women, if the stories were true. Before she really died, she was fond of saying she'd already died 6 times, if the stories were true. But nobody really knew if the stories were true. Now, sanctioned by history and a country judge, Dr. Cowper and his forensic sleuths hoped to collect post-mortem evidence to prove or disprove the possibility that Laddie Granbush was, as she long claimed, the infamous mistress of an equally infamous desperado. Dawn unfolded warm. Morgan sipped tepid convenience store coffee from a styrofoam cup and watched Cowper's young scientists prepare the machinery of their curiosity. Video and still cameras, high-wattage lights, a small gas-powered generator, mobile lab equipment, laptop computers, surgical instruments, and garden tools. A lone gravedigger pounded his pry bar into the powdery mortar between Laddie's sandstone blocks, peeling them away one by one and setting them gently aside in the dewy grass. A plastic grocery sack fluttered in the highest branches of an old cottonwood like a sentry angel keeping watch over the whole affair. The only sounds of the morning were the metallic clang of the gravedigger's spike, a meadowlark warbling somewhere in the cemetery, and the locust click of laptop keyboards. Laddie would have liked the attention, Morgan thought. Some folks said she clutched an old photograph of her outlaw lover to her pale, naked breast. Others said it was his Colt revolver. All the sheriff ever said was that Laddie Granbush seemed to be smiling when he found her. In the end, nobody knew for certain whether her last pleasant expression was a smile or merely the rictus of death, but Laddie would have been happy to know people would always wonder. That's how mere mysteries became myths. Laddie always liked the idea of being a myth. The gravedigger pried the lid off Laddie's cracked granite vault, exposing a simple oak casket. Morgan took a few steps toward it and shot a few more photos, but he was also morbidly curious. Would they still see Laddie Granbush's last smile? Could they boot up their computers and electron microscopes to peer inside her withered brain and see that last dream, the one that made her smile? And even if Lattie Granbush had once been known as Etta Place, Morgan wondered, could they analyze the dust of her heart and know if she truly ever loved a common horse thief named Harry Longabaugh, a.k.a. the Sundance Kid? Etta Place was a ghost long before Lattie Granbush fell asleep for the last time, and she especially haunted Dr. Sean Cowper. Only 36, Cowper was a wunderkind, already one of the nation's leading historical detectives, using DNA, the latest computer technology, and old-fashioned deduction to unravel some time-worn myths and dispel hoary hoaxes. His curiosity was romantic as well as scientific. He earned undergraduate degrees in literature and history. In one of his first cases, he proved some old bones in a roadside museum shanty outside Richmond, Virginia, were not John Wilkes Booth's, as claimed. Later, after an exhaustive year's study of unearthed genetic material, he reported it was statistically likely that Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer's body, or most of it, had actually been accurately and miraculously identified among the mingled remains of the Little Bighorn and reburied at West Point. Even in the haze of the Bucksnort Tavern, a Highway 12 roadhouse thick with cigarette smoke and jukebox twang, his young eyes generated their own light when he talked about Etta Place, the enigmatic mistress of a legendary bad man. Cowper's charbroiled, hand-padded burger sat uneaten in its nest of curly fries and limp pickles as he explained her mystery to Morgan the night before the exhumation. His beer glass sweated in the vulgar ambience of the honky-tonk, and he traced his finger through the wet puddles on the table as he drifted through another life, not his own, long ago ended. If not for Butch and Sundance, Etta might have been no place at all, Cowper said, relishing a cheap pun as only a scientist would. His eyes twinkled mischievously behind his studious wire-rimmed glasses. We don't even know her real name, and I've found credible evidence that at least 5 different people associated with the Wild Bunch used the alias Etta Place. What about Lattie Granbush? How likely is it that she is the real Etta Place? Morgan asked, swizzling a fry in a blob of ketchup. Cowper clearly savored the puzzle. Well, she's the right age. We're trying to match some later photos of her to a 1901 picture of her with Sundance. We can analyze bone structure, facial symmetry, and shape with a computer. We can even take a photo of an elderly woman and project her appearance into the past for a fairly good idea of how she appeared as a young woman. You gotta love computers. What about DNA? Cowper shook his head. Not much use in this case. We have nothing to compare it to. We'll harvest some tissue samples, but we'll most likely be looking for physical evidence to prove Lattie Granbush was not Etta Place. Like what? For instance, we'll be able to determine her living height within an inch. If Lattie was 5'1", we'll know she wasn't Etta Place, who was fairly tall, according to photos and the Pinkerton's description. An eagle's song hung in the smoke and drifted away. A drunken cowboy teetered on muddy boots at the jukebox until Patsy Cline began falling to pieces. He unhitched a cell phone from the hip of his Wranglers and dialed clumsily. He said something Morgan couldn't hear over the saloon's din, then held the phone up to the jukebox speaker until the song was done. The whole of his life boiled down to 3 chords and a sad story. Then he sat down alone at a dark table and talked to his Budweiser. What else do you know for sure about Etta Place? Morgan asked. Almost nothing. Maybe she was born Laura Etta Ingerfield, the illegitimate daughter of a feckless British earl who sent her to be reared by Fanny Porter, a San Antonio madam. Or maybe she was Amy Parker, whose cousin was Robert Leroy Parker himself. Butch Cassidy? One and the same. But I also think it's possible her real name has been lost altogether, like a shadow after the light is turned off. But she existed. You have photos. Nobody knew her? Sure, but you know how people are. The stories all get embellished and romanticized. Subjects lie, memories get foggy, secrets get carried to graves. Cowper ticked off all the reasons only good science was credible. She might have been a teacher with special talent for music. There's a little evidence she attended some of the swankiest schools in the East, all paid for by the sweat of Fanny Porter's girls, but there's equally compelling evidence she was a common prostitute in Texas. Take your pick. So bottom line, you don't know much for sure, Morgan said. He was beginning to understand Copper's fascination with secrets of the dead, but where Morgan's interest was sentimental, Copper's was empirical. I know she was pretty, from her pictures. She was no Catherine Ross, but her face was quite attractive. I know she was adventurous. I know she was smart. I know she held her own in a very tough environment. Even the Pinkertons described her as refined and beautiful. Who wouldn't love a woman like that? Everybody loves a bad girl, Morgan choked. Those were different times, Jeff. Lots of people came west to forget old lives, including women. Everybody had a past. It was no sin for a woman to be unladylike, even to screw around a little bit. Her reputation rested solely on how she treated other people. Today we might call Etta a bad girl, sure, but we've gotten harder to please. But not all frontier women hold up with bank robbers, Morgan said. Copper grinned. Okay, so Etta was a little wild. More than wild. One of my historians thinks she was married with two children when she deserted her family for Sundance. I've seen arguments that she was the kid's cousin because both of their mother's maiden names was Place, and they were childhood sweethearts. Others say Butch, not Sundance, was her cousin, as well as her first outlaw lover. So she got around a little. She knew how to have a good time. We have some letters where they call themselves a family of three, and the possibility of a ménage à trois has entered a few of these dirty historians' minds. Makes good legend, and legends make good movies. But if she entertained both of them, it didn't last long. We know she and Sundance took a train to New Orleans in 1900 and probably got married. There's no public record to prove it, but soon after, they honeymooned in Buffalo, New York. Outlaw romance, Morgan said. How sentimental. Well, maybe not. Their honeymoon suite was in a place called Dr. Pierce's Invalid Hotel. Back in those days, it was sort of a Betty Ford Center for syphilitics. It's very possible Etta was being treated for VD. Something borrowed, Morgan quipped. Copper smiled broadly and shook his finger at Morgan. You're bad, my friend, he said. The jukebox belted out a spunky tune by a popular country girl group, one of those farmer feminist protest songs that makes cowgirls put bumper stickers on their boyfriend's pickup trucks. The lonely old cell phone cowboy's brow furrowed, his mood suddenly as flat as his beer. He pushed his greasy Stetson back, exposing the white half of his forehead, and seemed to wonder where he went wrong. How sad to want to make a connection with someone but never know if the message was getting through, Morgan thought. Ever since his mother had been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease and gone to the Laurel Gardens home in Winchester, he wondered about all the invisible barriers in life. From cells that had locked in memories to the finite reach of a cell phone signal on a summer night. Morgan hankered to send a beer over to the old cowboy's table for comfort, not entertainment, but he clearly had enough. Instead, Morgan decided to offer him a ride home at the end of the night. Copper wolfed some curly fries in the lull and then continued his account of Etta Place's travels. Right after their pleasant tryst at the Invalid Hotel, she and Sundance boarded the SS Herminius for Argentina, and there the cold trail of Etta Place freezes solid. We think she returned at least three times because she was homesick or needed medical attention, maybe an abortion. For every fact, we have a dozen rumors and two dozen myths. Like what? One is that she was carrying a child, not Sundance's, and she came back to the States to give birth. Another is that she and Butch had a daughter in 1903. Personally, I think she just vanished after Sundance brought her back to Denver in 1908. Where? If I knew, I wouldn't be here with you and the Dixie Chicks tonight. Nobody knows for sure. Some think she went to New York, some Texas. Maybe she went back to South America. And there's a lot of territory in between, and a lot of stories. For instance? Well, one historian claims she died with Butch and Sundance in the 1908 shootout in Bolivia. A Pinkerton agent swears he inspected the corpses of Butch, Sundance, and Etta after a botched bank robbery down there in 1911. Some people say she committed suicide in the States in 1924 and others claim they can prove Etta, Butch, and Sundance all fought with Pancho Villa in the Mexican Revolution. And then there's Laddie. So just between us, what's your gut say? My gut is pissed that I haven't eaten this burger because I'm talking too much, Cowper joked. But we can't rule her out. We're still pulling together all the public records we can find. There's just not much out there. Not unusual for cases in that time period, especially for a woman in the West. Nobody really kept good records. So digging up Laddie is the beginning, not the end. We had to move fast when the county decided to relocate the grave. Your county officials gave us a very small window of opportunity, so there are still lots of loose ends. We won't be doing a full autopsy. We'll open the casket, shoot some film with Kreskin, our portable X-ray machine. One of our people will inventory and photograph personal effects buried with Laddie, like jewelry and clothing. Then we'll take a few tissue samples like hair and skin, maybe some bone, quickly examine her body and do some measurements, then move Laddie to her next rest stop on the highway to heaven. Then? Then we go back to try to make sense of it. Maybe we'll never know, but at least we'll have evidence to prove our ignorance. Morgan sat back in his honky-tonk chair, his green beer bottle stripped of its label. Gotta tell you, Sean, this is the biggest thing to happen to a corpse in this town since Carter McWang got drunk and rolled his hearse. Cowper nearly passed a curly fry through his nose. The lonesome cowboy gulped the piddling remnants of his beer and wheeled his loose-jointed knees toward the door. He slapped the leather cell phone case on his belt. High noon at last call. Morgan briefly thought about excusing himself to drive the old boy home, but maybe the night air would be better for him. The roomy-eyed cowboy pushed the tavern door wide and disappeared into the friendless night. "What about Butch and Sundance?" Morgan asked, wondering what becomes of old men when they vanish into the dark. "Do you think they really survived and came home?" Dr. Cowper turned his green beer bottle, as if he were screwing it into the wooden tabletop. "Oh, that's another project, my friend, another dream." "Why do you do this? Are you kidding? We wouldn't have invented history if we didn't want to know what happened before us. But sometimes history needs a little help. That's my job." "You seem to enjoy it." Dr. Cowper grew wistful. "When I was a kid, I read Mallory's King Arthur. The romance and the chivalry fascinated me, but I got this crazy idea that I could go to Avalon someday and find Arthur's bones, like it would prove the existence of Camelot and all it stood for." Morgan recalled his own youthful visions, and even pondered Etta Place as a latter-day Guinevere, sharing her passions with two men. He lifted his beer bottle in a toast to dreams and to Dr. Cowper, who waved him off self-consciously. "No, no," he said. "I think there's something perverse about a 12-year-old kid contemplating a life of grave robbing." Morgan lifted his glass to Cowper, and they drank anyway. "You have a family?" Cowper shrugged. He studied the greasy burger between his long fingers for a long moment, as if looking for some clues to the life of the cow. "My family is dead." Morgan turned suddenly somber. "I'm so sorry." "No, no, I'm just goofing around. My family is a bunch of ghosts and dried-out cadavers. I married my obsession. My children are old bones and computers. I spend all my holidays and weekends with them. The only bad thing is, I always have to visit them. They never travel." A scientist with a sense of humor, Morgan thought. Then again, maybe it wasn't so rare among men and women who spent their days with customers who never laughed. "Besides," Cowper continued, "what wife could compete with Etta Place?" Laddie Granbush's casket lid was already loose. Rather than lift it out of the vault, Cowper asked it be left where it was originally laid. He lifted the heavy top, blocking Morgan's view as he reeled off several photographs. Flanked by several team members, surgical masks in place and cameras clicking, the young anthropologist visually examined whatever remained of Laddie Granbush's mortal coil. From where he stood, Morgan couldn't see inside the casket, only Cowper's eyes as they methodically scanned the length of the box for a full minute. Then, with a surgeon's grace and equanimity, Cowper gently closed the lid. "Fellas," he said, stripping off his rubber gloves and mask, "we have a little problem." Chapter 2. Sheriff Highlander Goldsmith lingered around Lady Granbush's closed casket like a jumpy kid with a jack-in-the-box. The thick smear of Vic's vapor rub on his upper lip, a cop's precaution against the stench of decaying flesh, looked silly. Dr. Copper lifted the lid, and Goldsmith leaned forward from a safe distance, as if ready to run. His nose was pinched like an earwig's tail, and his Adam's apple bobbed in his scrawny neck as he craned to peek inside. The weight of his own badge threatened to unbalance him. Morgan squelched the morbid urge to holler, "Boo!" The sheriff was still examining the contents of Laddie's coffin when Carter McWain, coroner by virtue of being Perry County's only mortician, jostled over the speed bump at the Pine Lawn Cemetery gate. His sleek black hearse throbbed with an old Three Dog Night song, "Mama Told Me Not to Come," and his tubby head bobbled to the cranked-up beat. Until that moment, it had never occurred to Morgan that a hearse would have, or need, a bass-boosted, Dolby-filtered stereo system. "Yep, she looks dead to me," Goldsmith said, pulling a notepad and pencil from his neatly pressed uniform blouse. Dr. Cowper glanced at Morgan, the shadow of a conspiratorial smile in his eyes. "Mummification is a dead giveaway, Sheriff," Cowper said. "That and the lack of a head." Goldsmith nodded and made some notes as Coroner McWain stepped out of his hearse. He clicked his keyring as he waddled up, and the hearse's door locks chirped. Who locked a hearse? Morgan thought. What's to steal? Carter McWain locked a hearse. He was only a mortician, but he considered himself a medical professional, and he ornamented his life accordingly, with expensive possessions and habits. He even spoke expensively, always preferring clinical pedantry to some simpler expression, $10 lexicology where penny words would do. His customers weren't just dead, they were deceased of myocardial infarctions, heart attacks, cerebral vascular accidents, strokes, metastatic and malignant neoplasms, cancers, acute inadvertent misadventures, accidental deaths, and multiple fatal transportational traumas. McWain's own neologism for car crash injuries. Coroner McWain's appetites were ambitious and legendary, especially for food. Only in his mid-40s, he was as fat and bug-eyed as his late mortician father, Dorellis McWain, so fat that the underarms of his short-sleeved white shirt were sopped with half-moons of sweat just from his short drive to the cemetery. His surplus flesh cascaded down his body like a fat-flavored ice cream cone. He was a walking billboard for atherosclerosis, clogged arteries.
"My dad told Laddie this lung crypt memorialization wasn't a good idea. Folks around here prefer earth interment, and sandstone just isn't a good mausoleal stone. But Laddie was dead set on a crypt. She always said, 'Every day I spend above ground is a good day.'"
But the architecture of Laddie's eternity was less momentous than Dr. Cowper's next news about the corpse in Laddie's casket. No apparent wounds other than the missing head, but it's a pretty good chance this is a murder victim, Dr. Cowper told the two local officials who were now in charge of this new mystery. Goldsmith sighed. Murders were more troublesome than speed traps. Besides, he'd never handled a murder investigation in his 6 years as the law in Perry County, and he liked it that way. "Great," he said, almost disappointed. "You sure she was murdered?" "No, but somebody went to a lot of trouble here. This body was moved here from someplace else after the head was removed. People don't generally lose their heads over a natural death, if you'll pardon the pun." Goldsmith made another note. "She's all dried up. How can you tell?" "Unless I miss my guess, Sheriff, this isn't a she. It's a white male, possibly 40 to 60 years old, dead at least a year. In my business, we call him desiccated, but you'd just call him a mummy." "Him?" Goldsmith asked. The normally verbose McWain gandered down into the coffin and cocked his head sideways to study the headless corpse inside. The fleshy folds of the coroner's neck unfurled to reveal sweaty white pleats where the sun seldom shone. He breathed through his mouth, and the air droned at him like wasps in a wet vac. He didn't even remove his wraparound sunglasses, maybe because it required too much exertion. "Yes, Sheriff," Dr. Copper said. "This sure isn't Laddie Granbush, no doubt in my mind." Goldsmith lifted the bill of his official chocolate-brown, one-size-fits-all Perry County Sheriff's Office baseball cap and scratched his thin hairline. A fleck of vapo-rub clung to the tip of his beak-like nose. "How do you figure?" Dr. Copper slipped a ballpoint pen from his breast pocket and kneeled beside the grim box. The sheriff and the coroner bent over for an anatomy lesson from one of America's most brilliant forensic anthropologists. Even Morgan leaned closer. "Gentlemen," Dr. Copper said, directing their rapt attention to a leathery flap near the corpse's pelvis, "this is a penis." Dr. Copper's hand-picked forensic team became postgraduate pallbearers, hoisting the entire coffin onto Carter McWayne's morgue gurney and wheeling it to the hearse. Moving the fragile body itself would be too risky and might destroy clues. Dr. Copper himself checked the seals before closing the hearse's rear doors, then slapped the hot black roof twice. McWayne eased his wagon back onto the path and, for the first time in his life, carried a customer away from the cemetery. Sheriff Goldsmith said his goodbyes and followed the coroner through the wrought iron gates of heaven toward McWayne and Son's mortuary, only 2 blocks away. For good measure, he flipped on his red and blue vector lights, just so folks knew he had serious business. "Think they'll ever find that head?" Dr. Copper asked facetiously. "Doc, those two guys couldn't find each other's asses with both hands," Morgan replied. "Well, I can stay a day or two to help them find their asses and maybe a few more things. We can use some of this portable equipment, and I can take some samples back to Florida for further testing. If nothing else, it will be good real-world practice for some of my interns." The two of them stood silently at Laddie Granbush's dismantled tomb for a moment, while the team packed its gear back into its 2 green and yellow University of South Florida vans. A breeze rustled in the old cottonwoods overhead, but the hum of scientific machinery and anticipation was gone. "Will you be able to identify him?" Morgan asked. "Maybe," Dr. Copper said. "We still have a few tricks. I'll help in any way I can, but it will take some time. All is not lost for your John Doe. Not yet, anyway." John Doe. Morgan thought of the drunken cowboy in the buckhorn the night before. Anonymous. Alone. Unmissed. Then Morgan asked what neither the coroner nor the sheriff had asked, nor perhaps even cared about. But he knew it was on Dr. Cowper's mind, which thrived on mysteries. "Where do you think the old gal is?" the newspaperman asked as he snapped a photograph of the empty grave. Dr. Copper rubbed his tanned chin. His eyes were fixed on the empty vault where Laddie Granbush should have been. Even if she was not the legendary lover of the Sundance Kid, another chapter in the enigmatic saga of Etta Place had been written. And if she was Etta Place, well, like her outlaw companions, she'd been larger than life. Now she might have outgrown death, too. "Same place she always was," he said. "Where's that?" Dr. Cowper tapped his fingers on his chest and smiled. The morning DJs at KROK-FM, Curtis and the Bug, were up to their usual ribaldry as Morgan drove back to the newspaper office. These clowns started their suggestive shtick at dawn and giggled at their own juvenile jokes until noon. They made Beavis and Butthead sound like Nobel laureates. Morgan imagined families all over town sitting down to their breakfast tables, tuned into the farm report, the news, usually just headlines from the latest edition of the Bullet, or the school lunch menus. "Please pass the cornflakes," Father would say. Honey, did the Bug just say tit?" Morgan hated KROK, but the heart of the cassette player in his old Escort was sclerotic from eating too many tapes, and KROK was Winchester's only radio station, a glorified garage with an erector-set tower on the edge of town. Its mix was eclectic, depending on the DJ. Some days it was country, some days heavy metal, some days Christian. Once the afternoon jock locked himself in the booth with a pizza and a fifth of wild turkey and played Frankie Yankovic's greatest accordion hits without commercial interruption for 16 hours. Inexplicably, Frankie Yankovic was the most popular artist on KROK's request line for the next 2 months. "We've got a new Garth Brooks CD and an all-expense-paid weekend with Brenda, our skanky but bodacious receptionist, for the 9th caller this morning," Curtis announced in a pukey impression of a real DJ. The bug giggled in the background as they spun a Tracy Chapman song for the second time since their shift started. All Tracy Chapman all the time, Morgan muttered to himself. Goddamn small-town radio. He still missed Chicago's teeming airwaves, ripe with rock, talk, and Cubs games. So he turned off the radio as he pulled into the Griddle's parking lot for a cup of real coffee, nothing more. Headless corpses tended to dampen his appetite. A few ranchers bellied up to the Griddle's breakfast counter, the regulars. The radio was on in the kitchen, still thrumming with Tracy Chapman. Morgan plunked down next to Ray Pittman, a fourth-generation cattleman from up in the Black Thunder River breaks. Ray Pittman believed state road signs bore secret codes to tell New World Order tank squadrons who owned guns. He believed jet contrails in the sky were secret government plots to control population and inoculate Americans against their wills with anthrax and other strange diseases. He believed, because he'd once heard it on Art Bell's late-night radio talk show, that Thomas Pynchon and J.D. Salinger were the same person, although he'd never read either author's books. And every fence post on his ranch was crowned with an old boot, but he didn't believe there was any good reason. He just liked the look. "Hey, Ray," Morgan said. "Hey," said Ray. "What brings you to town?" Morgan asked. "Boredom," the old cowboy said. "And dog food. Damn mutt eats like a horse, except even a horse don't eat as much. I'd shoot the big dumb fucker if he wasn't less valuable than a bullet." Ranchers' casual attitudes about death always mystified Morgan. Unwanted kittens were piled in a burlap sack and tossed in the irrigation ditch. When beef prices were down, some thought killing the herd was better than selling it at a loss or allowing it to eat any more costly feed. City folk thought broken limbs were fixable, but a ranch horse with a broken leg was shot as useless. Morgan had built a career in part by poking his nose into death, but not over breakfast. He changed the subject. "I got a pair of old Tony llamas I've been saving for you," Morgan said. "I should bring them out someday."
"Llamas look good on a post, yes siree."
Without asking, Susie the waitress set a coffee cup full of pink sweetener packets in front of Morgan, then poured hot coffee in a tall go-cup. She knew better than to put the plastic lid on it until Morgan had dumped 4 sugars in it. "I heard on the radio where a body's chemistry turns that stuff into formaldehyde in your system and turns your skin gray like an embalmed corpse," she warned him. "There goes your tip." In truth, Morgan liked his coffee extra sweet, and his tea, and his oatmeal. Saccharin was merely the means to an end. He could quit any time, he told himself. Among his vices, it ranked among the most benign. "If you want to pickle yourself, you ought to just go get a direct IV of preservatives from Carter McWayne," she scoffed. "Wouldn't kill you any faster." "We all gotta die of something, Suze," he teased as he stirred his coffee. "It's not so bad to die of sweetness, is it?" Susie squared off, hands on her slender hips. She looked like a woman who'd had more than her share of lines from men and bought none of them. "Sugar, you used up every last drop of your sweetness making that little boy of yours," she scolded. "He's so cute, I don't know whether to breastfeed him or marry him." The radio ran out of music, and the kitchen again echoed with the voices of Curtis and the bug. Morgan gritted his teeth.
"Hey, dude, we got caller number 9 on the line," the bug chirped, "and you'll never guess who it is."
"No."
"Yeah, dude, it's that kid, Grady. Dude's been caller number 9 for like a month of Saturdays. How do you do it, man?"
A shy boy's voice came over the phone line softly. "Just lucky, I guess."
"Lucky? Dude, you got nothing better to do with your Saturdays than sit around and call the radio station?" the bug said. "You're what, 13? Haven't heard of masturbation? Can I say masturbation on the air?"
"You just did."
"Cool."
"So Grady," Curtis piped up, "if you're only 13, you might need some, like, pointers on what to do with..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.